Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Welcome and good morning. I think we'll start our prayers this morning asking God to rid our community of ice and flu, the two things that seem to be plaguing us this week. Draw near to God's statutes. The psalmist writes, so that we may observe them to the end. Let us be led in the paths of God's commandments, so that we may delight in the richness of God's life. Worship God in honesty and forthrightness, so that Christ's Spirit may perfect us for God's realm. Come, let us worship God together. Please join me in our prayer of invocation, which is printed in your bulletin. O God, you long for us to hear that the heart of your commandment is truthful love. Even more than that, you long for us to embody this way of integrity in all facets of our lives, dealing justly with our neighbors and even the strangers among us draws us close to the holiness of everyday life, the witness of Jesus, and the fruit of the Spirit. Inspire our worship that our lives may be transformed into living testaments of your grace. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And our prayer of confession. God, our source, and Christ, our foundation, we confess to you that we have often been careless in our construction of community. Even in the church, we do not live as if we are the temples of your Spirit, much less conform our individual lives to the wisdom of the cross. Yet you are still faithful in your love for us, calling us to be more than we are because of Christ, and filling us with the grace of your Spirit, so that we may yet embody your holiness and peace. Bless us, we pray, with the gift of love, that we may see you at all times and in all people. Hear now our silent prayers of confession. God offers to each one of us the gift of wisdom and the power of grace. This is not of our own doing, but comes from the very center of God's being. As we receive such gifts, we are shaped into the image of God, forgiven and whole. Let us sing praise to God.
Our psalm for this morning can be found on page 697 in the Pew Bible. It's number 119, verses 33 to 40. Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I will observe it to the end. Lead me in the path of your commandments, for I delight in it. Turn my eyes from looking at vanities. Give me life in your ways.
Confirm to your servant your promises, which is for those who fear you.
Turn away the disgrace that I dread, for your ordinances are good.
See, I long for your precepts, in your righteousness give me life.
And today's Old Testament reading is from Leviticus, a collection of civil, liturgical, religious, hygienic, and moral requirements that Israel was called upon to observe. Leviticus was drawn together around 400 BC, 8 centuries after the Exodus, when the people were returning from exile and beginning to establish their identity, rebuild their temple, and restore their national life. The focus of the book is on forming a people with a unique way of life that will distinguish them from all other peoples around them. Hear now a reading from the book of Leviticus, chapter 19, verses 1 and 2, 9 to 18. It's on page 130, starts on page 132 in the Old Testament. The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to all the congregation of the people of Israel and say to them, 'You shall be holy, for I am the Lord, your God, am holy. When you reap the harvest of your land, you shall not reap to the very edges of your field or gather the gleanings of your harvest. You shall not strip your vineyard bare or gather the fallen grapes of your vineyard. You shall leave them for the poor and the alien. I am the Lord your God. You shall not steal. You shall not deal falsely. And you shall not lie to one another. And you shall not swear falsely by my name, profaning the name of your God. I am the Lord. You shall not defraud your neighbor. You shall not steal, and you shall not keep from for yourself the wages of a laborer until morning. You shall not revile the deaf or put a stumbling block before the blind. You shall fear your God. I am the Lord. You shall not render an unjust judgment. You shall not be partial to the poor or defer to the great. With justice you shall judge your neighbor. You shall not go around as a slanderer among your people. And you shall not profit by the blood of your neighbor. I am the Lord. You shall not hate in your heart any one of your kin. You shall reprove your neighbor, or you will incur guilt yourself. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against any of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." Here ends the reading.
At this time, I'd like to invite the children to come forward for a children's message. I'll be dancing this morning. Good morning. How's everyone today? Think you go to school for a whole week this week? Any more snow? I wanted to talk to you this morning about two words that we find in the Bible a lot. We just heard a lot of them in the reading that Mrs. Estabrook did, and that is the word fear. A lot of times the Bible says that we are to fear the Lord. And what do you think that means, fear the Lord? Are we supposed to be afraid of God? No. No, when fear is used in that way, it means that we are to love and just be in awe of God. And so just always knowing that God is very powerful. But when we talk about fear, the other word that comes up in the Bible a lot is afraid. Because one of the things that Jesus says over and over and over, actually, both God and Jesus, it's in the Bible more than 50 times, is be not afraid, because God doesn't want us to be afraid of anything. So I thought what we would talk about this morning is what kinds of things, what are you afraid of? And I have an idea. This is what we're going to do. I have this box here. So I thought what we would do is we would write down what we're afraid of. Everybody take one piece of paper. And those of you that can write down, you can write it down, and otherwise I'll write it down for you. And then what we're going to do is we're going to take all of those fears and we're going to let God take care of them. So here's a pen. I want you each to write down one thing, the thing that you are most afraid of in the world. Can you write it down? And if not, I'll help you if you need help. You need help? Okay, who can write their own? Or you could draw a picture. Okay. You can write your own. You can write your own. Okay, and then you'll have to share your pens. Okay, so do you want to draw a picture or do you want to tell me and I'll write it down for you? You can decide. Can everybody think of something? Something that you're afraid, the one thing that you're most afraid of in the world. You don't have to tell me what it is. You know what? We're just going to write it on these and we're going to put them in here. I'm going to write mine. I'm going to fold it up and I'm going to put it in this box. And so here, why don't you draw a picture of yours? And then share the pens. And when you finish, you can put yours in this box too. Oop. Just put it in the box. Great. Jeannie, do you have one? Oh, Miss Lee? Sorry. Did you write something on your paper? Do you want Matthew to help you? You whisper to Matthew what you want to write on the paper and he'll write it down. How about you, Hannah? You need a pen? Okay. All right, who else is finished? When you finish, I'll take them. Not quite finished? Okay. Well, you can work on that and put it in the box later if you want. Because here's what we're going to do. We're going to take all of these things that we are most afraid of in the world, we're going to put them in this box, we're going to leave them in this box, and we're going to give this to God. We're going to let God take care of the things that we're most afraid of. We're going to fear not, we're going to be not afraid. Because that's what God promises us, is that he will, you want to put one in? All right. So as you go about your week, as you go about your lives, I want you to realize that with God, you don't have to be afraid. Thank you. Thank you. You don't have to be afraid. So keep that in your mind all week long. That can be the theme that goes through your head. Be not afraid. All right? Let's gather and say our prayers. And we'll leave these for God. We'll maybe pick the pens up. Can you hold hands? All right. So we close our eyes and we bow our head and we ask for God's blessing. And we say, thank you, God, for being a part of our lives, for protecting us and for helping us to not be afraid. We love you and we fear you and we are in awe of your greatness. Be with us every day and every night. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And now we pray together. All together we pray the Lord's Prayer, the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. All right, have a great day in Sunday school and be not afraid of anything.
Thank you.
seated. In the scriptures, God reminds us to be mindful of the poor and needy in our community and to make provisions that tend to their needs with respect and dignity. When all are afforded the chance to live and work in justice, we find that we have not lost anything, but rather have gained more than we could have imagined. As we share our gifts, we imitate. We imitate God and God's generosity with us. The morning offering will now be received.
Oh,
generous God, in grace you freely give, and in love you joyfully command us to imitate you. Let these gifts bear witness to the justice for which you long, and offer a faithful response to the loving care that you have first given us in your law, your prophets, and your Son. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Today's New Testament reading continues again with the Sermon on the Mount, with a focus on holiness, but holiness with a twist. Holiness in this week's readings is all about social justice, nonviolence, and community. Jesus' interpretation of the law challenges us to think beyond what we know to a new way of thinking and a new way of being. Hear now the Gospel according to Matthew chapter 5, verses 38 through 48. You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist an evildoer, but if anyone strikes you on the right cheek, turn the other also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your coat, give your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go also the second mile. Give to everyone who begs from you, and do not refuse anyone who wants to borrow from you. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Here ends the reading of God's holy word. May he add to our hearing and understanding his blessing. Amen. Please pray with me. O God, most holy, in Jesus Christ you have laid a foundation upon which to build our lives. Help us to follow your perfect law of love, that we may fulfill it and observe it to the end. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. One job that I know that I would not like to have is as an announcer for the Olympics. I would not want the responsibility of watching enthusiastic, gifted young people give everything they've got to a performance and having to point out all of the things that they did wrong. You've seen it these past few weeks, I'm sure, a seemingly flawless pairing of two beautiful skaters dancing across the ice. And just as you're wondering how on earth a human being could do that, the announcer goes, ooh, that'll cost them. And you sit up and you ask, what? What was less than perfect? My heart breaks for those athletes that perform almost perfectly, only to lose to a competitor by a tenth of a second. Perhaps we have events like the Olympics to remind us that even the best, the most well-trained, those in top physical condition with the ability of complete concentration, sometimes fall. They don't fail, they simply fall. No one, it seems, is perfect. As I was giving my children's sermon today, I pictured the panel in the back holding up 4.9. An article in Wednesday's New York Times told the story of figure skater Gracie Gold. In August, Gold turned 18 and her life seemed to fall into a panic. At a preseason training camp in Colorado Springs, she struggled. She could not rely on her jumping. She demanded perfection from herself and became consumed by her flaws. Her mother said she was really, really crumbling. A new coach and a sports psychologist were brought in. A transformation took place that Gracie attributed to releasing some of that perfectionist quality and switching her focus to excellence. She's won multiple championships since. She won a bronze team medal and came in fourth place in the short and the long skating performances at the Olympics. So she didn't win gold, but she got herself out there, and she did it. Reflecting on her performance in the short program, she said that doubt crept into her mind, and she had to keep pushing it out, replacing it with a message of confidence. And all of our readings today focus on what it takes to achieve spiritual perfection, holiness, and tells us what we have to push out and what we have to let in. The Old Testament reading, we heard the Lord's prescription through Moses of achieving holiness, and it is essentially a call to the return to the Ten Commandments with a reminder of who's in charge. I like the way that God presents this particular reading of the Ten Commandments. He says, "You are to do this." And the crowd says, "Who says?" And he says, "I say, I am the Lord." And so it's a reminder to us, again, of God's amazing power, that God is perfect, and that we are to try. And it is to this particular text from Leviticus that Jesus is referring in his sermon in Matthew's Gospel. But Jesus takes God's requirements even a step further. "You have heard it said, but I say to you, this is much harder than you think." Jesus calls us to a standard of behavior beyond what we know. He wants his followers to do something more, bigger, harder. He is demanding a level of excellence greater than that which we expect of ourselves. Loving enemies, passivity in the face of violence, benevolence to the point of poverty, radical hospitality, acceptance of every living being as a child of God. He concludes with the demand that we be perfect as our Heavenly Father is perfect. Well, for heaven's sakes, we know we can't be perfect. We certainly can't aspire to be God. But what Jesus is teaching, is trying to teach us, by framing the issue, "As you have heard it said, but I say to you," is that just because you have always done something one way does not mean it's the right way. He wants you to look at what you do and how you do it, and how is it moving you closer to that standard that God demands, closer to perfection. A book by Calvin Miller begins with this simple statement: "The only thing an eye for an eye and a tooth for the tooth is good for is creating an eyeless, toothless world." And so what we're left with and confronted with the question, is it more important to seek retribution or to meet evil with good? In his series of statements, Jesus is encouraging his followers to view justice and charity and forgiveness in a new light. In Matthew's gospel, he offers his view of perfection and holiness. Holiness is compassionate and it's nonviolent. It's refusing to retaliate when harmed. It's seeking the best even for those who consider us to be their enemies. What is clear here is that holiness is not about not doing things. It is about doing things that make a difference. It's not about avoiding sinful behavior, but about living lives of justice and compassion and fairness and nonviolence and generosity. It is about caring for those who are vulnerable and poor and treating all people the same with respect and with dignity. Gracie Gold, the figure skater, had to change her way of thinking from avoiding mistakes and falls and naming all her flaws to celebrating her gifts and talents and letting herself just soar across that ice. What Jesus is offering us today is a simple reframing of how we look at things. I know this is easier said than done. However, it is interesting to note that in this particular lesson, in Luke's gospel, it doesn't say be perfect as your Father is perfect. It says be merciful as your Father is merciful. And several translations say be compassionate as your Father is compassionate. So the simple lesson learned by the psalmist and Moses and Gracie and Jesus' followers is that holiness comes from acting holy. For some reason, we don't seem to be able to embrace this teaching. At the most simple level, Christian life has often been the cause of hatred and injustice, setting even believers against each other as enemies. Today, we may not use physical weapons, but we certainly use the weapons of the media and words and rejection. We do this against people of other religions, people of different cultures, people of different socioeconomic classes, people who look different. We do this on all different levels. And as long as we do this, we fall short of God's holiness. And we inflict spiritual death on both our enemies and ourselves. When we cut ourselves off from everyone else, or when we do this to ourselves, when we count our own flaws all the time, we are moving in a direction of spiritual death. It is when the offer of grace costs us the most, when it's hardest, when it's most difficult, that we are then clearly reflecting the grace and the character of Christ. To be perfect as our Father is perfect, as God is perfect, is very hard. It takes work. You can't do it by living a life of Christian light. You can't do it just by coming to church or just by saying an occasional prayer. It has to become who you are. It has to become how you act, both in the world and in your own families and in your church community. It becomes our being. Holiness, said one commentator, comes down to wholeness, integrity, authenticity, compassion, and hospitality. These characteristics are what God offers to us. This is how God loves us. And then God calls us to extend this to others, even those we most want to reject or condemn, including ourselves. How often do you reject yourself? How often do you put yourself down? But you are one of God's children, and God doesn't want to hear you put yourself down any more than God wants to hear you put your neighbor down. Remember that commandment is to love God and yourself and your neighbor. I am fond of saying, and many of you have heard me say this, that the work of the church is to love people into being. This means that regardless of how people behave, or what they say, or what they look like, we respond with love, with kindness, with gentleness. I remember Joe and I had a friend whose son went through a stage where he dressed in these outrageous clothes, and he had a dog collar on, like a chain on his neck, and he had big earrings, and he got all tattooed, and he would try to be like, don't approach me. And I would just always give him a big hug, And I would say, oh, I'm so glad to see you. You look so wonderful. And no matter what he did to try and push everyone away, we just kept stepping over that boundary. And he grew up to be a lovely young man. And I always think, well, we loved him into being. And we can do that here. And what this approach requires is that we put our own egos and our own agendas aside. So when the tattooed, earring, ripped clothes person comes to look for a place to worship, we think to ourselves, what an interesting person. I wonder what I can learn from him or her. So rather than look for flaws or shortcomings, each person we meet, imagine if every person you meet, I'm sure that none of you ever judge other people, particularly by appearance. So, but what this kind of holiness means, it means that when we meet a new person, we always start with the assumption, with the expectation that they are perfect, that they are holy. So rather than look for flaws or shortcomings or differences, we look to each person for their strengths and their abilities and the God-given gifts that they bring to our community. Try this. You have heard it said that the nominating committee is undertaking the annual task of building committees to carry out the work of the church, chasing people down and begging them to share the workload. But I say to you, the work of the church is honorable, empowering, enlightening, exciting, and transformative, and you are invited to be a part of that. The nominating committee is responsible for developing opportunities for each one of you to discern where your gifts and talents might best serve the church. See how easy it is to reframe? You have heard it said, but I say to you, what areas of your life might need a closer look like that? Are you operating on historical assumptions that are no longer accurate? With enough training and coaching, Gracie Gold was able to stop counting her flaws and to come out and compete on an international stage for a medal. She didn't win gold, but she gave it her best. And that is what God demands of us. I wonder if there is a slumbering Olympian in each of us that simply needs the assurance that we are indeed perfect as our Heavenly Father is perfect. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, we thank you for all of the gifts you have bestowed upon us. We are grateful for the abilities that we have, and we pray that you will show us how to use them according to your will. Our goal is to be perfect in our love for you and for one another. Grant us the grace to focus on our strengths rather than our weaknesses, and to see the good in our brothers and sisters. We want to be holy. We want to embrace holiness. Hear us this day as we pray for those whom we love. For those who are sick, we pray for healing. For those who mourn, we pray for comfort. For those who live with fear and hatred, we pray for peace and compassion. O God, our world is a troubled place. Grant us the strength and courage to bring your kingdom to earth. Hear us now in the silence of this meeting house as we turn to you with the prayers of our hearts. Amen. God calls us to do the impossible, to love our enemies, to confront injustice, to share bountifully with the poor. God calls us to be perfect in our imitation of God. God gives us everything, love abounding, the foundation of Christ, and the gift of creation. So go from here with God's blessing of a faithful spirit and a willing heart and a life of grace. And may the blessings of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and forevermore. Amen.